Yay, she's here!
How are
I got
you?
My red lips for you. I thought you'd be wearing your red lipstick too.
Well, I'm not wearing a red one. I'm so.
But you're nice and lovely and glowing.
You look great. You look great.
How are you?
I'm really well, and I'm having weird adjusting this thing. Hold
yes,
on.
Yeah, because I can kind of when just see your half face.
When I do it that way, is that better?
That's good. That's perfect.
No, I'm going to have to go back.
That's it. I can see you well.
Okay.
How are you? How you've been?
I'm really well. It's a very sunshiny, beautiful weather in London.
That's amazing.
I think it's beautiful weather where you are too.
Yeah, finally. It's sunshine everywhere. So we can actually kind of feed from that energy. You know, it's been, I don't know. I mean, for you, I guess it's been an interesting one because, I mean, for those that don't know Ruby, but, you know, many of you know of what you've achieved in your life. And it's great because you've started with a brand, Ruby and Miller, all those years ago. And now it's like you come back with a completely new brand. So it's like starting all over again. And then, you know, this hits and a beautiful career and, of course, in makeup and all of these things you achieved. But and then this hits. So that must have been a real kind of stop and shock to the system for you.
Well, the strange thing is a couple of things you mentioned. I've always been freelance. It's been 30 years of my career. So staying at home, it is not strange for me because, you know, I'm freelance. So however busy you are, even with the travel and going on location on a shoot in the country, out of the country.
Yes.
There's no one that's busy constantly. So I've had time to potter around at home and you organize yourself. And, you know, at the beginning of my career, I always had Rena, your friend, my daughter. So there were always things. So that wasn't as much of a shock to me. What was a real shock is that bit of suddenly, so staying at home is not an issue, but
yes,
that underlined fear of a bit of lack of control and fear of getting ill and people, your loved ones not safe, you know, like, so it's more of that little underlying thing that's more bizarre. So about being on my own or staying at home, I'm kind of used to that. I'm used to. And then the other thing you were saying is like, what lovely, in this long career and being freelance, there's a lot of up and down, you know, it comes in floods and then suddenly you're sitting there, oh my God, everyone else is working, I'm not working, I must be shit, is this any good, is it not? So because I'm a lot older, look, if
you are looking wonderful, by the way, don't even speak about your age.
3 decades on that. So maybe with age you just realize that, you know what, this is part of life. There's no this happily ever after, and I'm just gonna always be happy, or I'm gonna be constantly miserable, or however good and joyful things are, things do come, and this is the reality of life. From the day we're born to the day we're going to leave this planet, you have to kind of be realistic and take it on that it's never going to be one way. There will always be something coming. And if it's not to you, it's to your loved ones or humanity in general. And unless you're a stone, it's going to move you and you're going to feel sad about it, happy about it, upset about it. That's not unfair, you know, angry, whatever. So it's really your perspective and how you're going to address it, how you're going to deal with it that will steer you through, so that every day does not become a battle. Because if every day is a battle,
but that's what I noticed about you. You know, it's like you've got this. You know, whenever for the few times that I saw you, you always have this like youthful, this energy, and this up for doing things. And you know, like it's never like dull and sulky and complaining about things. You know. So it's that inner drive, you know, and it's, I mean, what has brought you to this? Was it like one event in your life, or is it just kind of accumulation of things?
Part of it, I must be, I mean, I think I have to thank the one above and my own genetics, you know, like, thank God I was blessed with this disposition.
Yes.
then the experience of life, and you know, I've been divorced from Rena's dad. What are you looking at? Is it okay?
There's a massive bee the size of on my head.
I'm scared.
I'll be fine.
Ignore it, it'll go away. So, you know, things in life, and then those experiences have shown you, you can either tackle it one way or look at it a different way. It doesn't mean I'm Mother Teresa, that I don't get upset and that I'm never,
of course,
you know, that I can't be a bitch. Or if jokingly, my husband aside, my husband, he thinks he keeps me youthful because he's so young. I drain his energy, apparently.
That's a good one.
I just feel you have to, is that being positive? You know, like, yeah, you can take it one way, and that doesn't mean it doesn't upset you. That doesn't mean you walk around with a fake smile on your face, you know, and block everything out. Because I'm not that. Everything, yes, you see in my face, and you see in my words, and you see in my disposition. And if I've messed up, I'm also, I put my hand up. I'm sorry. I got completely, I misunderstood, or that was really out of order. So I feel no shame in doing that, because I think, what is it? Is it just my awkward pride? There's certain standards I have, but there's also, is it ego, or is it really a principle or something, yeah, we mustn't budge from? So I'm not rigid about anything like that.
But tell me, how did you then suddenly decide to, well, it was kind of years and years that you have, I guess, passed since you launched Ruby and Miller, right? It was,
Ruby was 1996 to 1998 is when we launched it.
Exactly.
And the thing about it is, people think that that's all I've ever done before, but they forget that before that, me and my ex-husband, we launched Aveda. We
of brought course, exactly.
We brought Tweezerman, we launched L'Occitane, there's many other things that I've,
yes,
done while being a mother and while being an independent makeup artist.
Yes.
You know? So I just had to, it's different hats for different things, and you've got to understand that because we had no social media, we have none of this kind of barrage of where you can find information from. If it wasn't in a press release and wasn't featured somewhere, people don't really know about, exactly, what you've done in the past.
But then how did you come to this with actually relaunching completely new, completely on yourself, you know, with your own efforts? I think that's wonderful, but it's also very gutsy, right? You need guts for that.
It is gutsy, but, you know, I'm no different to any entrepreneur out there. You kind of see how the land lies. And I have to say that my mum died 8 years ago, and 2012. And I only launched my brand Ruby Hammer last year, 2019, September. Mm-hmm. So it takes a long time to be, you know, anybody that steps into the arena, and I call it, you know, the commercial arena, whichever form, whether it's a business, a restaurant, a hotel, whatever form that is, mm-hmm, you need to be quite resilient to know that you're going to take a lot of blows, body blows, you know, like there's a constant worry going on in there. How are we going to survive? How do we make the most of it? How is it creative? All the financials, all aspects, especially now there are many more other aspects to try and score points on,
yeah,
you know,
yeah,
be good. And to be honest, there's amazing people out there. So it's really tough. And then we look at what coronavirus has done to us globally.
Exactly.
I just think, what the hell? We didn't know, did we? I launched then, and then it hit some lovely stores just after Christmas. You know, it was in Harvey Nichols nationwide, and quite a few lovely soul houses in Berlin and Miami and Farmhouse and,
that's amazing,
Glen Eagles, lovely doors, but all those doors are now shut.
Exactly.
You know, so we've only got the website. So at the end of the day, it's took a long time where I felt good to think, yes, I'm happy to launch something again. But I looked around and I thought, I do not want to do something so mass and so big like I had done with Ruby and Millie.
Yes.
It's a lot of effort out of you. And a lot of money would have to be found. And then I'm very, in anything I've done financially or entrepreneur, my investor, whether that was somebody like Boots backing us, mm-hmm. or Avedo when they put their money, nobody's lost out money. So yes. I feel like not only you have to satisfy your own creative aspects, I need that person to make their money, but I can't sleep at night with that worry. So I just started
responsibility.
I just started off very small because I think it's my fingers on the pulse that way. People don't
it's like your baby, right? It's like
they don't have to do huge big things, you know, because there are big brands out there and good luck to them. Why do I want to knock? If I wanted to be a big brand now, I'd have to have 50 foundations at least, yes. to be representative in a good way.
Exactly.
It's a huge commitment that I've just think, what if Rena becomes a mum soon? And
yeah.
Or a good grandmother that can support her in her work, in her entrepreneurship. And
but I guess it's you also dedicating that time to yourself, you know, not draining yourself into work fully. I guess it's realizing what's important as well.
That's all it is. I've actually made a game plan that I think this is small and palatable. I can choose this. And God forbid, I hope not, if it all goes weird, I had a little bit of fun. I tried, you know, I tried. I think once the doors open again, touch wood, we're okay.
Yes.
People mustn't get frightened and scared because this is part and parcel of things happening.
Exactly.
Nobody picks that this is going to happen and I'm going to be, there's no ideal time to step into the arena. And while you're in it, we're going to do our best to fight without killing somebody, but just to sustain.
But can I just say, I mean, it wasn't just a brand. You're saying that it's a small brand, but I think it's very clever the way you came onto the market, not yet with another shade of, you know, shadows or skin. You came out with tools that really showed, you know, your years of experience and I guess your struggles with not finding the right tools at times and making things easier for the clients, you know?
Yes. And also, look, as a makeup artist, I have hundreds, if not thousands of brushes back there, if we counted every single one.
Imagine.
And I thought, yet again, I wanted to think, there are lovely eyeshadows out there. They're lovely, lovely brands. What am I going to do to knock them off the pedestal? I don't need to do that. I wanted something that was very inclusive, as well as, so you could use my little magnetic brush. I don't know if you've seen it.
Yes, of course.
Seen it, but you don't have one, do you?
I would. No, I've used it.
Next back here, I shall have one.
Oh, yay!
One there.
Thank you.
So it was just a little tool that was for people to keep in their desk. I mean, if they go back, when they go back to work, if, when. It was great to travel. Again, if and when we're allowed.
Of course.
Particularly relevant now because it's magnetic and it's got a lid. So it keeps it hygienic, much more so now. I didn't even think about that at that time, that, my God, it's very relevant now. And it should be your own one that you don't share with anybody.
Exactly.
And you can use it for eyes, lips, concealer, whatever you want to do. Once you've bought it, it's yours. You do with it what you want. And I wanted it to be able to be used with, whether it's a Charlotte Tilbury or Victoria Beckham or it's a McGrath or it's a L'Oreal drugstore thing, whatever it is,
exactly,
the more you use it, the more useful it should become.
Exactly. And I've seen your tutorials and it's great because you realize how easy it is. You don't have to become this super incredible, you know, person that applies all this contouring and stuff. It's actually like a very easy tool to use. So I think it's,
and I really pleased myself about that. And a lot of my makeup artist colleagues, they keep it for on set. So they do it for retouching and they keep it swift and fast. For every woman, it's easy. Like even my PR, when she had it and she, you know, she was getting used to it and then she'd gone away on a weekend trip. She said, Ruby, it was only when I went away and the more I used it, I realised how.
Of course.
At the end of the day, it's not really an advertorial about my brush. I just wanted to say I've always dealt with something commercially or personally when it's relevant and it speaks to me. So you might think, oh my God, what are you doing with just one thing? But I think, do you know what? It feels right for me. And that's what I would say to anyone out there starting up or has started up or is slogging out there, that don't do it because of the expectation, oh, this is going to bring me a lot of financial reward, or it's going to suddenly give me name and fame and blah, blah, blah. And, you know, I'm going to be this. It has to come from within you that you are able to take that knock and really feel, I don't care what anybody says about it, I really love this. And no one can take that away from you.
And it becomes, I think, genuine, and it reflects in the brand and people feel it. And I think...
Truly.
And I think many times, you know, like moving forward, especially, I feel like people would want to connect to brands' experiences that are genuine like that, that they're not just about the numbers and how many, you know, likes you got under a picture or whatever it is. I think it becomes bigger than that, right? It becomes much more about the connection.
And don't get me wrong, the bigger the brand, the bigger the numbers. What can they do? They can't just shrink, can they? They have to. It is a big machine, and more people are going to see how authentic and whether they have integrity, you know, like whether that's about sustainability or whether it's just the message that you give out.
Yeah.
And this period of time has actually shown a lot of reality that people sometimes were not aware of. It has come to the forefront that some that you think, oh my God, I always liked that brand. I never bought anything from them, but they're really decent. And then some people you thought, oh, I always thought they were just about this. And that's been, not that I want to name names, but I'm just saying people have become aware of all that. You know, you can't pull wool over anybody's eyes.
Exactly. But you're also, I mean, even before this lockdown, you know, you're always constantly involved with what I call doing good, you know, because I feel like whether it's helping a friend, I know you've done things with these funky sweaters, you know, just, I mean, you've done always things that I think felt always genuine and not for just the sake of, you know, some people do, I think, charity, unfortunately, for the wrong reasons and for publicity or whatever it is. But like you were saying about launching the brand, I think everything that comes from you is usually genuine and it feels right for you, you know?
I mean, I hope so, because to be honest, it's very selfish. Doing good feels good. Makes me feel good. So, you know what? I do it because it makes me feel good, but I don't also do it like, to be honest, any bit of charity, however little you do, benefits somebody. So as long as it feels good. It feels good. So I'm doing it not for anybody else, but again, for me. And I do it in a way that resonates with me. Like, look, we did something for the National Health, and I didn't have the initiative. It was another wonderful makeup artist called Caroline Barnes. And she sort of sent an email and she said, Ruby, would you be interested? And I said, what is it? And she said, I want to do something for the National Health, all the doctors and the nurses and the women there, long hours. It's so relentless for them. We want to give them a NHS morale boost. So she set up this little thing, and all of us, she says there's some that didn't, but most of us came on board because, oh my God, we'd love to be able to do something, however little. So we gave a day, and she organized it, and it was fantastic, where we just did these half an hour Zooms. And they were nurses, they were doctors, radiologists, you know, all sorts of people. And we had a half an hour, bang, 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 bang.
You were doing tutorials?
Well, tutorial, face-to-face, just one-to-one with them.
Amazing.
And sometimes we had a couple of no-shows, but I would text her immediately to say, it doesn't look like this person's going to come in. Have you got anybody else?
Yeah.
Waiting list, so they slotted in. And we did that, not just me, a whole bunch of people did that to appreciate. So it's a small thing, but it gave those amazing women and those people at the forefront of the National Health a little respite, something to ask for themselves. Because again, we think of our industry as not as superficial, it's cosmetic, but deep down it's shown us in this lockdown that it is a huge industry and it does affect our well-being. So whether that's a bit of red lipstick like you've got on, trying to put your skin, having a lovely candle,
yes,
burn and smell, just proper food to eat, a little bit of exercise, meditation, whatever that form takes. And you asked me at the beginning that why are you like this? I think I could have been a different way. What if I was born bipolar? What if I was prone to this? I would have to now, thank God we don't shy away from some of these taboo words. Before it was like, I'm at the tail end of menopause, and it was like, oh my God, people didn't talk about that. Horrible.
Yeah.
Or mental health. We've had Mental Health Week. We've had all kinds of things that are now considered non-taboo, whether that's racism, whether that's sexism, whether that's inclusivity, whatever that is. Although I never use the buzzword, that is how I've lived my life, you know, so I'm not going to suddenly change, and I might be in the arena or not, but those are what matters to me. And that's how I've been raised. And that's what's important to me. So I'll try and do address things that way.
But do you also feel like now more than ever, you're able to kind of, do you feel like sometimes you charge people with this way of being, or do you share this way of being with those around you to like kind of inspire them? Because I think for many, it is difficult to even put the red lipstick on, or they think, oh, it's not for me, you know, oh, it's too superficial, like you're saying. But in fact, you know, it's like these little
The best way to inspire someone or to someone is the fact that if somebody can see that it's genuine, that you've got nothing to gain out of it, you know, you're not going to make some money out of it, or when they can feel that is genuine, and also just by, you don't have to shout like in Hyde Park Corner and bully people into doing it. You can do it by example, and there's a gentleness and reinforcement. Nobody becomes a great person or a good person by one good act.
Yes.
You don't suddenly become a great artist because you just did one painting.
Yes.
And your body of work is shit. Or somebody's evil just because they made one mistake or they did something genuinely terrible and awful. So constantly it's about the positive reinforcement and seeing that thing again and again and again. And people looking and thinking, oh yeah, that person hasn't changed their tune. They kind of, we all evolve as people. Nothing in this planet is at a standstill. Everything has to evolve, and you have to get forward. Like even us, look at this technology. I never was able to do that. So I think as long as people see that, it's reinforced and it's genuine, and you think, oh my God, yeah, it plants a little seed in you. And I'm inspired by other people, so then I try. And if somebody does that for me, wonderful. You know, and I think that's the only way you can actually say, look, it's not rocket science. I wasn't doing what those doctors and nurses were doing. But it made those people who had to work God knows how many hour days,
exactly,
a little bit of light or glow or a little boost.
Exactly.
I had a hand in that. What can I say? I'm not a brain surgeon. You know, I'm not a scientist. But it gives some, it's just a smile, a genuine smile, or ringing somebody or giving somebody a hug that we can't do. Imagine how valuable that is when, you know, you're deprived of hugging somebody that, you know, before it would be a stranger or people you love, you know, I mean, unbelievable.
And I mean, they always tell me to keep to half an hour, but the time always flies and I have so many.
Yes, it does. Yes, it does.
But for me, I guess what people love about these is to kind of have your takeaway, your tips, you go to things that, you know, have worked for you either in the time, you know, cause you are lucky that you have a partner, you know, that you can be under one roof with. But maybe for people that also don't have anyone and are just alone, or it's this, you know, somehow like takeaways for this vibrancy, a life of, you know, to kick that in themselves. To wear red lips sometimes? Is that maybe why?
Sometimes it is that. But the most important is just your perspective. So yes, I'm very fortunate. I have a partner now and we are self-isolating together. But you've got to realize I was married for 15 years and then I got divorced. Yeah. And at that time, I had only left my mother's home to go to my husband's home. Yeah. And then I was totally on my own in my own apartment, working freelance. My daughter was a teenager, not living with me. She wanted to go and be with her dad for a bit because I think it was agony for her to see how much pain and how down I
was. Yeah.
It's not like I don't know what it's like to be on your own and having to think, oh my God, I'm going to have to learn how to change a light bulb. I have to feed myself when you don't feel like eating anything. Nothing gives you joy. I've been there. I know that. And the most important thing is just your perspective. Be grateful, because yes, it could be appalling.
Yes.
It could be appalling, but it's never as bad as your own situation. It's never as bad as somebody out there, and it's a hell of a lot better than a lot of other people out there, and maybe not quite like somebody out there, but you can't just envy things. If you just do that, I think everything else falls into place. Like, I might not have washed my hair for 3 days and I think, you know what, I couldn't be bothered. Today, yes, I will, because it feels nice to have fresh smelling hair just for me.
Yes.
Or you say things like to drink water, to do this, to meditate, to do whatever it is, to feel free to not deny yourself, not suppress it. It can come out. I think it helps if you have not necessarily a religious part, but some sort of spiritual something.
Yes, something you believe in.
Believing.
Yes.
And maybe whatever that little ritual can be, whether it's a beauty, a bath, a facial, a hair thing, just to do that, or just to ask the universe, give me strength, show me a way, can I smile through this? And try. Fake it until you know, a smile. Oh, it might not reach your eyes today, but 3 days later it will reach your eyes. So just the effort.
Oh, this is so nice to hear.
And that's all I try and do. And that's
really genuine.
Being fake about it, because that has more damages. More damages.
Exactly. Oh, there's so much good, positive charge coming from you.
Well, all the people you've had have said things like that when you've chosen.
I know, and it's so nice.
And
so nice, because you know,
thank you, Jamila, because you are also very vibrant and all the
thank you.
Me, but you are like that, and one has to remember, and you're a young mum, so you've got little ones there that you have to have another, not just doing your business and your work. You've got a youngster that you have to also do. So,
but you know what? I think out of all these, what I love about this series is that I genuinely get people that do connect in very similar ways that I do, and that's what makes, for me at least, and I hope for those that join, the conversations that much more pure. And you know, and I hope everyone takes something out of it, you know. And
the love is now we can save this, and hopefully it can just, it's like a book, you know, when you love
exactly.
A you could go back and you don't have to read the whole book, but you can just tap into something and it will give you. So if you save all of this, all of us, from all the things that we've done in this time, I hope there's a lot to take away to bolster up for what the future is bringing.
Exactly. Amen. And all the strength to us, I swear. Thank you so much. It was such a beautiful conversation. Thank you for coming on and agreeing to do
that. Lovely to see your face. I can't wait to see you when you're back in.
I know, me too. So God bless. Stay this positive. And we will keep on continuing seeing everything that you're doing and supporting you. Thank you so much.
Speak to you.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.